Hello, I'm Dr. Russell Barkley. I'm a clinical professor of psychiatry at the Medical University of South Carolina in Charleston, South Carolina. Welcome to this internet course on ADHD medications. Before we begin, let me share with you my sources of financial support for the previous year so that you can evaluate whether there exists any potential conflict of interest with the contents of this presentation. I do receive a retirement pension from the University of Massachusetts Medical School, but obviously I am not retired. I also have spoken for a number of professional associations, hospitals, healthcare agencies, and other groups during the previous year, as you see here. I do have a number of products in the marketplace related to ADHD, such as books, videos, newsletters, and internet courses such as this one, for which I receive royalties. And finally, and for this presentation most importantly, is the fact that I have served as a speaker for, or consultant to, several of the major pharmaceutical companies that have ADHD products in the current marketplace. I also served as an expert witness on behalf of Eli Lilly in a patent legal dispute approximately a year to a year and a half ago. This course is about medications used in the management of ADHD. This course is not intended to teach physicians how to prescribe, titrate, and otherwise monitor medication use for ADHD children and adults. Textbooks on psychopharmacology and professional practice guidelines are available to serve that purpose, along with package inserts with the various medications. The purpose of this course is to acquaint the participants with the various medications that are available for the management of ADHD, their common effects, some of their side effects, and issues involved in selecting medications for individuals diagnosed with ADHD. For more on medication use with ADHD, please read the chapter by Dr. Daniel Connor in my ADHD Handbook for Diagnosis and Treatment. The first issue to consider is why use medication at all with ADHD individuals. First, stimulant medications, atomoxetine, which is Strattera, or guanfacine XR, which is Intuniv, are among the most effective treatments available for the management of ADHD and have among the largest evidence bases for their safety and efficacy of any treatments available for this disorder. The safety of these medications is incredibly well established. Stimulant medications have been available since the 1930s to 1950s, have been prescribed to millions of individuals, often for months or years at a time. They have also been extensively studied, with more than 400 studies of stimulant medications being available at this time. Similarly, atomoxetine or Strattera has been studied in more than 4.5 million patients and originally was studied in rigorous double-blind placebo studies in more than 6,000 individual patients. Guanfacine XR, or Intuniv, the most recently approved drug for the management of ADHD, has also been reasonably well studied for its safety and efficacy. The medications for ADHD improve the majority of individuals treated with these drugs. Between 70 and 90% of clinical cases will respond to at least one or more of the ADHD medications currently available. In fact, more than half of patients will fall within the normal range in their degree of symptoms when they are placed on these medications and an appropriate dose has been identified. This is far greater than is the case for any other treatment for ADHD. Psychosocial treatments such as behavior modification, classroom management, or parent training programs tend to produce smaller degrees of improvement and do not normalize this degree of patients. In general, 30 to 50% of individuals provided with psychosocial treatment are likely to show a normalization of behavior. So the medications remain among the most effective treatments that we have available for ADHD. Medications, compared to psychosocial interventions, are also incredibly convenient to administer and typically are far less expensive than other forms of intervention. Although medications do produce side effects, some of which are annoying, they are quite safe. It should also be kept in mind that psychosocial treatments also produce side effects, although they have not been well studied. The few forms of psychosocial treatment in which side effects have been studied have identified them. For instance, research shows that between 10 and 20% of families that receive behavioral parent training and up to 25% of families of adolescents that receive family therapy for dealing with ADHD and related disorders are likely to worsen as a consequence of being exposed to these treatments. This has also been found for other treatments, such as social skills training, in which nearly one-fourth of ADHD children may become worse as a result of being exposed to such treatment, particularly in groups where other aggressive children may exist. For more on this problem of deviancy training and side effects of psychosocial treatments, please see my course on this website with regard to parent counseling, parent training, and classroom management. Medications are also far less expensive than are psychosocial therapies when provided over the same span of time. This is not a trivial issue, given that families have limited resources to spend on treatment and they need to avail themselves of the most effective and cost-efficient treatments available. Medications can be used for years of time, even into adulthood. So long as impairment remains, medications can be used to treat ADHD. This is often not the case with various psychosocial treatments, which are time-limited. Finally, medications can be active in various settings where there are no caregivers to supervise the ADHD individual, and therefore can be incredibly convenient to administer when children or adults are outside the supervision of others and their ADHD symptoms have to be well managed. For instance, for children, this may be unsupervised activities in the community, such as playing with other children. For adolescents and adults, it may be driving alone or with friends, but outside the control of parents or parental supervision. It may be during recess or free times in school, such as in the hallway or the lunchroom where supervision is inadequate, or such as bus rides to and from school. These are activities in which the individual cannot be supervised and in which psychosocial treatments often cannot be provided. Consequently, having medication available at these times to help control ADHD symptoms may result in improved functioning in these situations, as well as a reduction in the potential harm that could befall the individual if their symptoms were not well regulated. There are currently three types of medications approved by the FDA in the United States for use with ADHD. These are the stimulants, specifically the drugs methylphenidate and amphetamine. More recently, atomoxetine, which is Strattera, which was approved in 2003. And finally, and most recently, guanfacine XR, an antihypertensive drug, also known as Intuniv, approved by the FDA in 2009. The first class of drugs for ADHD management that I will consider are the stimulant medications. As I've indicated, the stimulants are among the most well-studied drugs in psychiatry and pediatrics, particularly for the management of ADHD in children. They have been used since the 1930s to 1950s, and more than 400 studies now exist that evaluated the safety and effectiveness of these medications for ADHD. Thousands, if not millions, of cases of children and adults with ADHD have been treated with these medications since their availability, and so a great deal is known about how to use these medications, their effects, and their side effects. There were three kinds of stimulants available up until nearly a decade ago. These were methylphenidate, the amphetamines, also sometimes called D and L amphetamine, and pemoline. Pemoline, otherwise known as Silert, was taken off the market some years ago because of a low but significant risk for the potential failure of the liver in children. As a consequence, pemoline is no longer available in most states in the U.S. But methylphenidate and the amphetamines remain treatments that are widely used for the management of ADHD. Now, while individuals sometimes show poor response to one of these medications, such as methylphenidate, trying both medications often results in a response rate of nearly 90%. This is also true for trying the different delivery systems available for each of these medications. Sometimes individuals respond well to one delivery system while not responding as well to several of the others. This is to say that the individual's response to medication is often relatively unique. Some individuals will respond at low doses but deteriorate at higher doses. Others will show the opposite dose response curve, doing poorly at low doses and yet achieving adequate therapeutic control as the dose is increased. Some individuals are also threshold responders, where increasing the medication appears to provide no benefit until a particular threshold of a dose is achieved, at which point a remarkable improvement may be evident in their symptoms. All of this is to say that it is not possible to draw conclusions about an individual's response to one type of stimulant from how well they have done on the other type of stimulant, nor is it necessarily possible to conclude how they will do on one form of delivery system if they have not responded to others. Finally, it is not possible to conclude how well individuals will do on the non-stimulant medications I will talk about later in this presentation compared to the stimulant medications. So, physicians should view the use of medication and the adjustment of medication as an activity that requires tailoring the particular dose and medication to the individual, and not attempting to approach the use of medications for ADHD with a standard algorithm that is believed to apply to all patients. Over the past decade, one of the most obvious developments in medication use for ADHD has been the availability of new systems that deliver the medication into the body. While no new stimulants have become available, new delivery systems have become available that help to keep these medications in the body longer so that they can be taken less frequently during the daytime. I refer to these delivery systems here as the 5 P's, representing the pills or immediate release forms of these medications that have been available for decades. Also the osmotic pump, known as Concerta, that I will talk about briefly. The time-release pellet technologies for both methylphenidate and amphetamine, such as Focalin XR or Adderall in the case of amphetamines. There is also a methylphenidate skin patch available for use in the management of ADHD. Finally, and most recently, there is the new category known as a prodrug. This is available for amphetamine, and I will describe it later. This is the reference I mentioned earlier at the beginning of this presentation that I encourage individuals to consult if they would like to know more about the stimulants. This is an excellent chapter by Dr. Daniel Connor, now at the University of Connecticut Health Sciences Center. Besides the immediate release pills that have been available for many decades for methylphenidate and amphetamine, more than 10 years ago, a new delivery system was invented known as the OROS, or osmotic pump technology. This drug is called Concerta. Concerta is a miniature water-based pump, and you can see it represented on the left-hand side of this slide. If we open up the Concerta capsule, we see inside that there is a drug chamber located here, and then an empty compartment located here. And then there is powdered methylphenidate on the outside of the capsule. When the capsule is swallowed, the powder on the outside of the capsule goes to work immediately. This gives time for water to be absorbed at a continuous rate into this empty compartment known as the push chamber. And as water is absorbed in this chamber, it begins to gradually put pressure on the drug chamber, squeezing out a methylphenidate paste for up to 10 or more hours. So this is a very nice invention that permits children and adults with ADHD to take medication once daily while the medication is squeezed out of the pump over the course of the waking day. Previously, with the immediate release pills for amphetamine and methylphenidate, medication often had to be taken 2 to 3 times a day in the case of children, sometimes even 4 times a day in the case of adults, because the medication typically lasted only about 3 to 5 hours at best. Now, while this is a different delivery system for methylphenidate, it has the same side effects and the same positive effects or benefits as does the regular methylphenidate. Its advantage is that it keeps the medication in the bloodstream over a much longer period of the day. The next graph or slide shows what happens when the Concerta capsule is activated and the medication is squeezed out of the chamber. Notice in the graph above that we see the time course for Concerta as graphed against taking methylphenidate 3 times a day. You see here the problem with immediate release methylphenidate, and that is that there are peaks and valleys in the control of behavior and in the availability of the drug in the bloodstream across the day, sort of a roller coaster ride of medication management of the ADHD symptoms. With Concerta, the medication stays in the body longer and maintains a more even blood level across the day, as you see here. This eliminates the need to take medication multiple times a day while sustaining a therapeutic dose of the medication in the bloodstream for a large portion of the waking day. The third technology that became available is a time-release pellet technology. This is available for methylphenidate and for Adderall, and it goes under various brand names such as Focalin XR, Ritalin LA, Adderall or Adderall XR, and in Europe, Metadate CD. When the capsule is swallowed, the time-release pellets become available for absorption. Some of the pellets have coatings on them that allow them to dissolve immediately. Others have thicker coatings that allow them to stay in the body longer and to dissolve at a later time. So some of the pellets are dissolving immediately, others are dissolving at 1, 2, 3, or 4 hours across the day on up to 8 to 10 hours. Again, as with Concerta, this allows the medication to remain in the body over a longer period of time using just a single dose. As you see in the graph here, the pellet delivery system compensates for the typical decrease in blood levels of the medication that may occur if the immediate release pill system is being taken by the individual. So just as with the oros medication, blood levels are sustained across the day, eliminating the need for taking the medication multiple times a day. An additional advantage of the pellet delivery system is that for children who have difficulty swallowing capsules, the capsule can be opened, as you see here in the photo at the left of the slide, and the medication sprinkled on food such as applesauce, as you see here, and then consumed. This does not change the pharmacokinetics or the time course of action of the medication when this is done. So this is a particular advantage of this delivery system over other delivery systems. Now, if we compare the Oros delivery system used by Concerta with this time-release pellet delivery system, one needs to understand that they do not reach their peak blood levels at the same time during the day. Both medications are very good at controlling ADHD symptoms across the day, particularly the school day, but they don't reach their peak at necessarily the same time. Research done at the University of California at Irvine by Sharon Weigel and her colleagues suggests that the Oros medication system reaches its blood level at a slightly later time during the day than does this pellet delivery system. So if a child has difficulties at a particular time of the day more than other times, for instance, more in the morning than in the afternoon, then the pellet delivery system might be a preferred choice. On the other hand, if the child has more difficulties in the afternoon to early evening hours, then it might be better to use the osmotic pump or Concerta delivery system. But in general, both delivery systems achieve a similar degree of control of ADHD symptoms across the day. They just don't do it necessarily at the same peak time of day. Now, the fourth P that is available as a delivery system is the skin patch. This is a dot matrix transdermal technology in which methylphenidate is contained in a patch, and the methylphenidate is absorbed through the skin. The patch is typically worn on the shoulder or on the buttocks, and the patch can stay on all day. As long as the patch is on, medication is available to be absorbed through the skin and into the bloodstream. However, the patch must be taken off several hours before bedtime to allow the medication to break down and be excreted from the body and to not have any significant adverse effect on sleep onset or insomnia. About 1 in 6 individuals may develop a skin rash using this particular delivery system, which is a consequence of the drug irritating the skin. These individuals will find other delivery systems to be of greater use. But in general, over 80% of individuals who use the patch are able to tolerate the medication absorption through the skin. Finally, the last delivery system, developed in 2009, is called a prodrug. In a prodrug, an active medication, in this case, D or dexamphetamine, is locked up by another chemical so that it cannot be activated. In this case, the other chemical is lysine. By binding lysine to dexamphetamine, the amphetamine cannot be activated until the lysine is split away from the chemical, at which point the dexamphetamine can be activated. This is a very long-acting medication, typically having effects that last at least up to 10 hours per day, and for many individuals, even longer. The medication is given once daily, as with the other long-acting delivery systems. The medication can be taken with or without food, and it does not change the availability of the drug within the system. Let's have a look at the lisdexamfetamine molecule to see how it works. This is a picture of the molecule as it exists within the drug. However, when the drug is taken orally and begins to break down in the gut and then is absorbed into the lining of the intestine and into the bloodstream from there, there is an enzyme available in the gut and in the bloodstream that splits off the lysine from the amphetamine. This splitting allows the amphetamine molecule to become active and now produce similar effects to other medications that use D-amphetamine as their basis. This drug was developed in order to reduce the abuse potential of amphetamine, which is a drug that does have a relatively high abuse potential and street value. By locking up the amphetamine this way, it ensures that the drug is unlikely to be activated unless it is in the human gut or in the human bloodstream, at which point the lysine can be split off and the medication activated. When this drug became available, it was discovered that the medication may last as long as 12 hours in many individuals, and in some, even longer than that. Otherwise, this medication has the same effect and side effect profile as do any of the other dexamphetamine delivery systems. About 70% or more of patients are likely to be improved on this particular medication, which is consistent with the other stimulant medications and with the other delivery systems. The advantage of the lisdexamfetamine system, known as Vyvanse, is that it may produce longer behavioral control across the day than some other delivery systems, and it has a reduced abuse potential relative to other delivery systems for amphetamine. One issue that has been investigated during the past decade has been whether or not stimulant medications can be used safely with preschoolers. These medications have been approved by the FDA for use with ADHD children down to age 5 to 6, depending upon the medication under consideration. However, the medications have been used off-label by many clinicians with children under the age of 5. It therefore became important to determine whether or not there was any increase in safety issues or side effects in using these medications with children younger than 5 years of age. Within the last decade, the National Institute of Mental Health initiated a large-scale study of the effects of methylphenidate on preschool children. This study is known as the PAT study, or Preschool ADHD Treatment Study. In this study, over 300 preschool children diagnosed with ADHD between the ages of 3 and 5.5 entered the study protocol. The protocol required that all of the preschool children be provided behavioral parent training to their parents before they would be allowed to enter the drug protocol. This was in case children responded well to the behavioral parent training and might not need the medication. But as you see here, more than half of the children did not do so well in the behavioral parent training and had residual ADHD symptoms to a sufficient degree that they then progressed on into the medication trial. In the medication trial, children were tested on 3 different doses of methylphenidate. As you see here, the methylphenidate was given 3 times daily. So this is a study that used the immediate release form of methylphenidate. What the study found is that the medication produced smaller changes in ADHD symptoms than typically is the case with school-age children. As you see here, the degree of improvement, known as the effect size, was about 0.4 to 0.8 compared to 0.8 to 1.2, which is the effect size normally achieved in individuals of school age. Now, an effect size is simply a measure of the number of standard deviations of improvement between the placebo condition and the active medication condition. And so you can see here that the effect size was about 0.4 to 0.8 standard deviations, when in school-age children it is significantly higher than that. This study also found that a smaller percentage of preschool children fell in the normal range during the active medication use. Here you see that it was about 22% of preschool children were normalized in their behavior, whereas the comparison figure for school-age children is between 50 and 60%. What this means is that preschool children showed a smaller degree of improvement on the medication, and a smaller percentage of them were normalized by the medication than typically occurs in school-age children. The study also found that there was a slightly greater likelihood of children experiencing side effects on the medication. No new side effects were evident in this study, but more preschool children were likely to experience the typical side effects for this medication than is the case in school-age children. Also, as you see here, a slightly greater percentage of children simply could not tolerate the medication than is the case in school-age children. The figure is 8% for the former, whereas it is 3% for school-age children. In general, there was some growth delay experienced by the children in the study. This is typical of studies of stimulant medication in all children. Nevertheless, the medication was relatively well tolerated, and it was effective. No new side effects were evident. But in general, the study reached the conclusion that preschool children may not show quite the same degree of improvement, that a smaller percentage of them respond to the medication or are normalized by the medication, and that a slightly higher percentage of the children may not be able to tolerate the drug or may have more side effects from the medication than is the case in the school-age population. In general, stimulant medications like methylphenidate, based on this study, could be considered to be safe and effective for use with preschool-age children. Now let's have a look at some of the benefits or behavioral effects that are produced by the stimulant medications. In general, these medications improve ADHD symptoms, particularly difficulties with concentration, resistance to distraction, and persistence over time toward goals. They also reduce hyperactive and impulsive behavior. As a consequence of these reductions, there is an increase in work productivity, particularly in school, related to academic tasks. There is more of an effect on production of work than there is on accuracy of work done. But as I indicated in my course on school management, the greater problem the children with ADHD have in school is with work productivity and not so much with the accuracy of their assignments. Children on medication miss fewer days of school and may show an increase in their reading achievement if they are kept on medication for at least several years. We also find that there is a decrease in the likelihood of the child being retained in grade or being disciplined in school. Many children show increased control over their emotions on these medications. There is also a decrease in aggressive behavior and in symptoms of oppositional defiant disorder. Some studies even indicate a decrease in antisocial activities within the community in ADHD children and adolescents who are taking these medications. Also, treating the individual into their adolescent years has been shown in a few studies to actually lower the likelihood that the individual may begin use of nicotine and also may reduce their likelihood of developing a substance use disorder in their adolescent years. Additional benefits from the stimulant medications are listed on this slide. There is improved compliance with parental and teacher commands and a greater capacity for following rules at both home and school. There is also improvement in various executive functions, particularly inhibition and working memory. Some studies even suggest that the internalization of language, which is the basis for verbal thinking, is also improved by these medications. Many studies going back nearly 40 years have documented improvements in handwriting and in motor coordination and control when children take these medications. You may recall from my other courses on this website, particularly that dealing with childhood, adolescent, and adult impairments from ADHD, that children with ADHD often have difficulties with motor coordination and development, and particularly with handwriting. So it is nice to see that these medications may be having some positive benefit on this area of impairment in the disorder as well. Several studies have shown that children on medication have an improved sense of self-esteem relative to when they are not taking the medication. This probably has to do with the greater success that they are having at home, in school, and in their peer relationships. They are also less likely to be punished by others, and appear to be more accepted by their peer group and to have more positive interactions with their peers when they're on medication than when on placebo or off medication. A few studies have examined whether or not the medications improve sports performance, and while there is an improvement in motor coordination, as indicated above, in general, children are not necessarily any better athletes on medication than when off medication, but they do show a greater attention to the games that they are playing and make fewer mistakes when they are participating in sports when on their medication. Studies by myself and others indicate that ADHD has an adverse effect on driving performance, as I discussed in my course on adolescent and adult outcome of ADHD on this website. Other studies show that giving medication to ADHD individuals does improve their attention span, their reaction time, their inhibition, and their driving ability. This would suggest that these medications ought to reduce some of the adverse consequences in driving that people with ADHD are likely to experience. Other studies have also shown that ADHD medications can be effective in managing ADHD symptoms even when they occur in the context of autistic spectrum disorders. For many years, people believed that you could not use stimulant medications to manage ADHD if an individual also had a comorbid autistic spectrum disorder, because it was believed that the medications might make the stereotypic mannerisms, the anxiety, or other symptoms of autism worse if the medication was used in the context of an autistic spectrum disorder. But this has not been found to be the case. Studies show that the ADHD symptoms can be managed, even if ADHD coexists with autism, by using the stimulant medications. However, a few of the studies indicate that there was a slightly greater incidence of side effects in these individuals with autistic spectrum disorders when they were treated with ADHD medications. But the difference was relatively minor. All medications have side effects, and this is certainly the case with the stimulants. But the side effects associated with stimulants are relatively benign, even if they are particularly annoying to some individuals. About 5% or fewer of ADHD individuals are able to tolerate these medications, show intolerance to these medications. The figure may be slightly higher in preschool children, as I indicated earlier. But in general, about 3-5% of individuals simply can't take these medications because they can't tolerate them. But in general, more than 95% of individuals tolerate the medications reasonably well. All of the side effects that are known to exist with the stimulant medications are dose-related, so they are likely to increase with increasing dosage. The most common side effects are seen here in the middle of the slide. Indeed, many studies indicate that these are the only side effects that are usually statistically significant in the study. The most common side effects are delayed onset of sleep or insomnia, occurring in more than half of ADHD children, a loss of appetite, particularly for the noon meal, also occurring in more than half of ADHD children treated with stimulants. To a lesser extent, some children and adults complain of headaches and stomach aches when taking these medications. A very small percentage, usually less than 10%, complain of increased irritability, and some individuals complain of a proneness to tearfulness or crying. Nervous habits, tics, or nervous mannerisms may be slightly increased by these medications, but in general, fewer than 10% of individuals on medications have these difficulties. Less than 3% of them appear to develop tics or Tourette syndrome when taking the medication. These are usually individuals that have an increased family history of nervous tics or Tourette syndrome, suggesting that they are genetically prone to experiencing these side effects. I'll discuss this side effect more in the next few slides. Certainly, many ADHD children show some degree of growth failure or growth delay on these medications, but the degree of impairment in growth is typically quite mild, averaging about 1 to 4 pounds of failure to gain weight during the first year on the medication. This effect on weight gain, or this delay of weight gain, may actually persist for several years. But by adolescence, there is no indication that taking medications such as the stimulants for ADHD results in any alteration in predicted height and weight for an individual. Thus, these effects on growth appear to be relatively transient. There is also an effect on height, as you see here toward the bottom of the slide. On average, individuals fail to grow about 1 centimeter per year while they are on this medication, compared to individuals not taking the medication. Nevertheless, as with the failure to gain weight, this appears to be a relatively transient effect. Again, no studies have indicated any significant effects of stimulants on the adolescent or adult weight or height of individuals who have taken medication for managing their ADHD. Overall, it appears that the impact on growth occurs during the first 1 to 3 years of stimulant therapy and does not continue thereafter. Indeed, some studies suggest that there may be a rebound in growth or height by the adolescent years. One study suggested that stimulant medications might result in damage to chromosomes, particularly chromosomes in red blood cells, and that this might pose a risk for increased propensity for cancer. Subsequent studies have not found this to be the case, and indeed, exploration of the methodology of the original study found that it was relatively poorly conducted and could not be used to conclude that there was any damage to chromosomes from taking medication. There is no evidence, therefore, that stimulant medications predispose individuals toward any risk of cancer. Many studies indicate that stimulant medications produce a slight increase in heart rate and blood pressure. The increase is relatively trivial unless the individual is already in a morbid range for heart rate or blood pressure, such as individuals who may already have pre-existing high blood pressure. African American males in particular are known to be somewhat more prone to high blood pressure, and therefore these individuals should be screened more carefully for the possibility of having pre-existing high blood pressure, and therefore one would want to avoid using stimulant medications with these individuals. In general, it is good medical practice to take a baseline evaluation of heart rate and blood pressure before starting the stimulant medications. A few studies indicated that there was a slight but significant increase in the risk of stimulant hallucinosis, or a psychotic reaction to the stimulants. In general, this occurs, on average, in about 1 to 2% of children who take these medications. The most common reaction is hallucinations, particularly tactile hallucinations, or the sense of feeling things crawling on the skin. This is a very rare side effect. It is typically dose-related, and the hallucinosis usually is discontinued once the medication has been stopped and it has been eliminated from the body. So it is a transient phenomenon. Studies that have followed ADHD children into adulthood have found no discernible effects, adverse effects or consequences, that is, from taking these medications across years of time and into adulthood. From time to time, claims have been made that stimulants increase the likelihood of sudden death in children or adults who take these medications for management of ADHD. In order to evaluate this claim, one needs to know the base rate in the population for sudden death in individuals who are not taking stimulants. As you see here, that base rate is between 1 in 7 individuals out of every 100,000 individuals in the population are likely to experience sudden death in any given year. This is a very, very low rate. When children with ADHD or adults with ADHD who are taking stimulants have been studied, the research indicates no higher incidence of sudden death in these medicated individuals than is the base rate in the population. Indeed, several studies find that the rate of sudden death is much lower. Therefore, there is no indication that stimulants increase the risk of sudden death in the general ADHD population. The reason that the rate of sudden death might be somewhat lower in individuals taking medication is that, unlike the general population, people are often pre-screened for cardiac abnormalities before going on stimulant medication, and therefore these individuals would not be given this medication, and that would result in a reduction in the likelihood of an adverse reaction to the stimulants, that is, an adverse cardiac reaction, occurring in the stimulant-treated population. In general, the stimulant medications come with a warning that it is not advisable to use them in individuals who have a prior history of significant cardiac problems, structural heart abnormalities, or previous occurrence of heart surgery. There are a number of misconceptions about the stimulant medications in the general population, largely due to the adverse publicity that these medications receive from time to time in the general trade media. In general, the trade media does not represent these stimulant medications particularly accurately. So it's not uncommon for people to believe that stimulant medications are addictive when they are used as prescribed. This is generally not true. To become addicted to these medications, individuals often have to crush the medication and inhale it or inject it intravenously. But taken as prescribed, there is little, if any, evidence to show that there is a risk for addiction using the medications as prescribed when orally ingested at the doses that are typically used for managing ADHD. Another misconception is that stimulants may increase aggressive behavior or assaultive behavior. All evidence available shows that children on medication are less aggressive and show less antisocial activities than ADHD children who are not taking medication. Another misconception is that the stimulants may increase seizures in individuals by lowering the seizure threshold. Studies indicate that this is not true. Even individuals with epilepsy can take stimulant medications safely. Only at very, very high doses does there appear to be an increased risk for seizures. These doses are such that an individual would have to consume a large quantity of stimulants to achieve this threshold. So in general, stimulants may be safe and effectively used with individuals who have seizure disorders or epilepsy. There was concern that stimulant medications might increase tics or even bring out full Tourette syndrome in individuals who take them. More careful studies have shown that the vast majority of individuals, even those who already have tics and Tourette syndrome, are not adversely affected by taking these medications. Indeed, about a third of individuals with tic disorders or Tourette syndrome found their tics to decrease in taking stimulant medications. Nevertheless, some studies suggest that about 30% of individuals who have a pre-existing tic disorder may find that their tic frequency increases to some extent while taking stimulants. Overall, the stimulants can be used safely with individuals with tics or Tourette syndrome, but clinicians should monitor the individual's tics to see whether or not they are in the minority of individuals whose tics may be exacerbated by the medication. Where that is the case, stopping the medication and switching to a non-stimulant is probably the best course of action. Usually, this results in a return to the baseline frequency of the tics. A few children may show tics in response to medication who previously did not have a tic disorder, but these are usually children who have a family history of tic disorders and therefore may have been prone to tics, a proneness that the medication has simply brought out. Once again, stopping the medication often results in a return to baseline for these individuals, typically within 7 to 10 days. There is some concern in the U.S. population that ADHD individuals may be being overdosed on their medications. But studies that have been done show that this is not the case. What they show is that in general practitioners and pediatricians are very conservative or cautious in the doses that they are using to treat ADHD. Indeed, they may often be under-medicating the disorder in comparison to psychiatrists who tend to use higher doses of medication and tend to have somewhat better success in managing individuals as a result. But overall, there is no evidence that we are using excessively high doses of stimulant medications with children in the U.S. population. There are other misconceptions about the stimulants as well. For instance, many individuals in the U.S. believe that we are over-prescribing these medications, which is to say that more individuals are taking the medication than may actually have the disorder in the population. In general, between 7% and 8% of school-age children and between 4% to 5% of U.S. adults have ADHD. You can see here that in general, only about 4% to 5% of children are taking medication at any point in time for management of their ADHD, a figure that is far below the population base rate of ADHD for children. This figure suggests that about 60% to 65% of ADHD children may be taking stimulant medication in the population relative to the population that has ADHD. For adults, only about 1 in 10 adults with ADHD is being treated for their ADHD, which is to say that nearly 90% of adults with ADHD in the U.S. are not taking medication for management of their ADHD. What these figures indicate is that, if anything, medications are underprescribed in the U.S. population rather than being overprescribed. This is not to say that there are not some neighborhoods or localities where some physicians may not be overusing these medications. That may well be the case. But at the level of large communities or geographic regions of the U.S., evidence suggests that we are under-medicating rather than over-medicating the population. The media has portrayed stimulant medications as if they are likely to increase the abuse of other stimulant medications later. That is to say that individuals who take these medications are believed to be more prone to drug use disorders later in life as a consequence of having taken stimulants. This is absolutely false. There is no evidence that suggests that individuals who take these medications for years in childhood are more likely to be drug abusers in adolescence or adulthood. 15 studies have examined this issue and have not found this risk to occur. There was one study by Dr. Nadine Lambert that did appear to suggest that children who took stimulants might be more likely to abuse or to use stimulants in adolescence or adulthood. For instance, they might be more likely to use nicotine or to use cocaine. However, when this study was examined, its statistical analyses were viewed as inappropriate because it did not control for the coexistence of conduct disorder in these individuals. Conduct disorder is a disorder known to increase the likelihood that individuals will experiment with or abuse substances. When comorbidity with conduct disorder is controlled for in various studies, there is no association of stimulant medication with increased risk of drug use or abuse in adolescence or adulthood. It is often said that stimulant medication cannot improve school performance. This depends on what you mean by school performance. If you mean behavior, productivity, and grades in school, then there is ample evidence that stimulant medications do improve these aspects of school functioning in children with ADHD. Many studies indicate increased productivity, improved classroom behavior and rule following, better peer relations, and improved grades in school as a result of improving ADHD symptoms. There is also a reduction in the frequency of punishment, fewer days absent from school, and a lower likelihood of having been retained in grade in children who are taking medication compared to ADHD children not on medication. Nevertheless, if the complaint focuses on school achievement, meaning knowledge, or the scores one attains on annual academic achievement tests, then there is little evidence that stimulants improve knowledge or achievement. But then why would they? Pills do not contain facts or knowledge, and therefore taking them does not grant one knowledge they did not know previously. Typically, in short-term stimulant medication studies lasting only a few weeks to a few months, such studies indicate no improvement in academic knowledge or achievement from having taken a stimulant. But more recent studies that have followed children for several years on medication indicate that there may be some improvement in academic achievement, particularly in reading test scores, in children who have stayed on these medications for several years. Nevertheless, even if these medications do not improve actual knowledge or achievement, they do improve class behavior, grades, social relationships, and so forth, and those improvements alone are worth using the medication to treat ADHD, even if there is no improvement in academic knowledge. Some research has been done looking for possible predictors of which individuals may respond positively to the stimulant medications. Most of this research has been done with methylphenidate. In general, these studies suggest that, first of all, age may be a predictor of drug response. As indicated earlier, children in the preschool age group may not respond quite as well to these medications, and fewer of them may show a positive response to the medications than is the case in the school age population. Once individuals enter elementary school, however, there is little evidence that across the elementary grades for any differences in drug response. On average, between 70% and 90% of individuals in this age group are likely to respond to stimulant medications. By adolescence, this figure is generally around 65% to 80% may respond to the medication. This difference from adolescent to child drug response is not significant. By adulthood, again, between 65% and 80% of adults are likely to respond well to one of the stimulant medications in the marketplace. In general, it is in the preschool age group where significant differences exist in drug response. The severity of ADHD symptoms may also be related to the degree of positive response, which is to say that individuals with more severe symptoms of ADHD may show larger improvements in symptomatic management than individuals with milder ADHD. A few studies have suggested that family history of drug response may be an important consideration. Where family members who have taken the same drug have had a good response or reaction to the drug, then the individual under consideration for the medication is also likely to have as good a response. This suggests that there may be some genetic basis to positive responding to the medication. Where individuals in the family have had an adverse drug reaction, the individual under consideration for medication may also be likely to experience adverse drug reactions. So in general, it is a wise idea for clinicians to inquire about a family history of reactions to the particular medication that is being considered for prescribing to an ADHD child or adult. Recently, a couple of studies have suggested that the dopamine transporter gene, known as the DAT1 gene, might be related to drug response to methylphenidate and atomoxetine. In general, individuals with a particular version of the gene, known as a polymorphism, responded better to the medication than those who had a different combination of this polymorphism. The numbers 9 and 10 here refer to the number of copies of the gene that are concurrently located along the chromosome of the individual. The dopamine transporter gene is known to vary in length, and individuals vary in the number of copies they have sitting adjacent to each other on their chromosomes. The research suggests that individuals who have the heterozygous condition, that is, one copy of the 9 version of the gene and one copy of the 10 version of the gene, may actually have a better drug response than those who have 2 copies of the 10 version of the gene. More research on this issue is clearly indicated, but it does suggest that in the future it may be possible to genotype individuals with ADHD and use the knowledge of their genetics to determine which drug they are most likely to have a positive response to. Now, it makes sense that the dopamine transporter might be related to response to methylphenidate and atomoxetine because both of these drugs are known to be reuptake blockers. Methylphenidate, for instance, is known to be a dopamine transport blocker in that it blocks the reuptake mechanism on dopamine nerve cells so that more dopamine remains outside the nerve cell in order to remain active. Atomoxetine, in contrast, is known to be a norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor. These results suggest that the dopamine transporter gene may have some effect both on norepinephrine reuptake as well as on dopamine reuptake. Now let's move on to the first non-stimulant medication that was approved by the FDA for treating ADHD in children and adults. That drug is atomoxetine, which goes by the brand name Stratera. Atomoxetine is an exclusive norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor. It is not a scheduled medication because it has no abuse liability or potential. This is probably because the drug has virtually no effect on the reward centers of the brain, known as the nucleus accumbens, in the midbrain. Stimulant medications are known to produce effects on this structure and on the reward center, and therefore have some abuse liability. But this is not the case with atomoxetine. The drug was approved for use in the United States in 2003, and thereafter has been approved in several other countries in Europe and elsewhere. The drug is one of the best-studied medications examined in double-blind, placebo-controlled studies before being brought to market. More than 6,000 children and adults were tested on this medication before approval was sought by the FDA, or from the FDA, rather, by the drug company, for use in ADHD. As of this writing, the medication has been used in more than 4.5 million patients worldwide. In general, the results of the double-blind studies indicate that the drug is effective for managing ADHD in children, in teens, and in adults. The medication, in fact, appears to have equal effectiveness in terms of the percentage of individuals likely to respond to the medication when compared against drugs like methylphenidate, for instance. In general, between 70 and 80% or more of individuals placed on atomoxetine show a positive response to the medication. However, more recent studies suggest that the degree of improvement in ADHD symptoms from atomoxetine may not be quite as large as the degree of improvement one gets with methylphenidate. You can see the comparison here when we look at the effect sizes. Remember that an effect size is the proportion of a standard deviation, the symptoms improved between the placebo and the active drug condition. As you see here, atomoxetine has a slightly lower degree of improvement, or effect size, than we see with methylphenidate. But in general, this drug appears to be nearly equally as efficacious for managing ADHD as the stimulants. As I've said, about 75% of individuals show a positive response to atomoxetine if they have not previously been treated with any ADHD medication. In children and adults who may have previously shown a poor response to stimulants, research shows that approximately half or more of these individuals did respond to atomoxetine, suggesting that atomoxetine may be a good drug to consider in individuals who have not shown a positive response to stimulants. This makes the point that I made earlier. Response to a stimulant medication does not necessarily predict response to the other medications for ADHD available in the U.S. marketplace. Studies have shown that the positive response to atomoxetine has been sustained for at least 3 years or more in individuals who have stayed on the medication for at least that long. Indeed, studies indicate that the longer an individual stays on atomoxetine, the greater is the improvement they are likely to experience in their ADHD symptoms. Now, while atomoxetine is typically given once a day in the morning, It can also be given in a split dosing, with half the dose given in the morning and the other half taken in the evening. Sometimes this approach results in fewer side effects for individuals, and yet what studies indicate is that there is no difference in the benefits of the medication across the day as to whether the medication is taken once a day or in a split dosing of morning and evening dosing. In general, the drug appears to have effects across the waking day and may have effects for up to 24 hours after the medication has been taken. This slide shows the positive benefits that have been documented in individuals taking atomoxetine. What the research shows, of course, is generally improved symptoms of ADHD, improvements in symptoms of oppositional defiant disorder, or ODD, and a reduction in aggressiveness. Some studies indicate that internalizing symptoms, such as anxiety, may actually be improved by this medication. Indeed, a few studies show that children and adults with ADHD who have anxiety disorders may find some positive benefit in the treatment of their anxiety symptoms from taking this medication. More recent studies also show that atomoxetine improves executive functioning in individuals with ADHD, at least as measured by rating scales of executive functioning. As with the stimulants, atomoxetine results in an improvement in school productivity, school behavior, peer relationships, parent-child interactions, and self-esteem, as was found with the stimulants. Also, some studies conducted by the company that owns the medication did show that there was improvement in the number of dry nights in ADHD children that had enuresis or who were bedwetters. Studies have also found that individuals taking atomoxetine have better behavior the subsequent morning after the medication has been taken than individuals who don't take the medication or individuals who may have taken stimulant medication. It is not clear why this morning after dosing behavior would be improved. Perhaps it has to do with the fact that atomoxetine does not have an effect on sleep onset or on insomnia, as do stimulant medications such as methylphenidate. As you see here, only 7% of individuals who took atomoxetine reported difficulties with falling asleep at night, versus 30 to 50% of children who have taken stimulants like methylphenidate. Indeed, some studies have found that individuals who take atomoxetine may actually fall asleep faster than those individuals on placebo. Now, around 1 in 10 to 1 in 5 individuals who take a stimulant experience a side effect known as emotional blunting. Typically, parents report that children on stimulants in these cases appear to show a restriction in their range of emotion. It is often described that they appear to act like robots or automatons, or simply don't show much emotion at all. While this has not been documented in controlled studies of stimulants, it remains a complaint that clinicians report in a minority of their patients treated with stimulants, and in my experience, this complaint appears to be related to the dosing of the medication. Higher doses are more likely to result in this complaint. Nevertheless, I have not heard of this complaint in individuals taking atomoxetine. Perhaps this is because, as recent studies have shown, atomoxetine does not produce any effects on the limbic system of the brain, which is the emotional brain, whereas stimulant medications like methylphenidate appear to result in a reduction in activity in the limbic system. Such reduced activity might be the source of the complaints that emotions are being restricted in individuals taking stimulant medication. As with the stimulants, some research shows that atomoxetine can be used to treat ADHD symptoms safely and effectively in individuals who also have a comorbid autistic spectrum disorder. These individuals appear to respond to the medication in nearly half or more of all of the treated comorbid cases, and appeared to have fewer side effects to the atomoxetine than did autistic spectrum children with ADHD who were taking methylphenidate, abbreviated MPH on this slide. As with the stimulants, atomoxetine does have some side effects. Most of them are benign, are dose-related, and are relatively short-lived. This drug, as with the stimulants, does increase blood pressure, but only to a small degree. It also has a small increase on heart rate. There is some temporary failure to gain weight in children who are taking atomoxetine, and this may be to the same degree that has been shown with stimulant medication. However, children who have been followed up for longer than a year, evidence shows that they no longer appear to be experiencing this growth retardation. There is a very minor effect of atomoxetine on height gain, probably less than that seen with the stimulants, and again, as with the stimulants, the effect on growth and height appears to be transient. There was one individual who appeared to experience some inflammation of the liver as a consequence of taking atomoxetine. This is one case in 4.5 million individuals who have been treated, so the risk of liver problems on atomoxetine is extraordinarily rare, and probably is a result of a very unique autoimmune reaction to the medication in such individuals. Now, several years ago, the FDA placed a black box warning on this medication for the possibility that it might increase suicidal thinking in children. There was no evidence for any increase in suicidal thinking in adolescents or adults. But there was one study reported by the company that suggested that about 0.3% of pediatric cases taking atomoxetine complained of suicidal thinking. This is 5 individuals out of more than 1,300 children that were treated in that study. Now, before we can evaluate whether or not this is an increased rate of suicidal thinking, we need to know the base rate of suicidal thinking in children with ADHD who are not taking this medication. As I've indicated in my course on this website dealing with comorbidity, about 6% of children who are not treated for their ADHD complain of suicidal thinking. This figure rises to nearly 33% of ADHD teenagers in high school who have such a complaint. Compare these numbers, 6% of children, 33% of teens, to the number of individuals who are being treated with atomoxetine who complained of suicidal thinking. It is less than 1/10 of the individuals complaining of suicidal thinking who are not treated with atomoxetine, and less than 1/100 of teenagers with ADHD who are not treated with atomoxetine. Indeed, these numbers could be used to argue that atomoxetine actually might reduce the risk of suicidal thinking in children, but I am making no such claim here. What I wish to do is to show you the evidence, and based on the evidence, there is no indication, as far as I can tell, that atomoxetine might increase suicidal thinking in children. I believe that this black box warning was probably inappropriately placed on this medication. Now, individuals do vary in their ability to break down and metabolize and excrete this medication from the body, and it appears to be the CYP2D6 genotype and pathway that results in some individuals having more or a higher blood level of atomoxetine than do individuals ordinarily in the population. These individuals may have much higher blood levels than individuals without this particular genotype. Nevertheless, even in individuals who experienced at least 2 to 3 times the blood level of atomoxetine showed comparable tolerability and rates of discontinuation from the medication, as did individuals who were not slow metabolizers. A drug that was approved for ADHD management in 2009 is guanfacine XR, going by the brand name Intuniv in the United States. Guanfacine is an antihypertensive drug. It is also a medication that had been used previously to treat ADHD off-label and to treat tics and Tourette syndrome. The company that manufactures this drug came to market with an extended-release form of guanfacine for use in ADHD, and this is Intuniv. This medication works in the brain as an alpha-2 agonist, which means that it works differently in the brain than do the stimulants or atomoxetine. In its immediate release form, it is a relatively effective antihypertensive drug used to treat high blood pressure. The extended release form was approved by the FDA for use with ADHD in 2009 in a particular range of doses. Guanfacine XR appears to improve both dimensions of ADHD symptoms and may be better than guanfacine immediate release or than clonidine, another hypertensive, for management of ADHD due to the fact that guanfacine XR appears to have less sedation, less effects on cardiac functioning, and therefore may be safer to use and safer to discontinue than may be clonidine or guanfacine immediate release compound. Notice that the effect size or the degree of improvement in ADHD symptoms from guanfacine is somewhat less than that seen with stimulant medication at these dose ranges. But at higher dose ranges, the degree of improvement in ADHD symptoms now approaches that seen with stimulant medication. Approximately 50-65% of individuals tested in research on guanfacine showed a clinically significant reduction in their ADHD symptoms relative to baseline. This figure is similar, though not quite high or as high, as the degree of improvement seen with stimulant medications. Nevertheless, it shows that many individuals show a positive response in reduction of ADHD symptoms as a consequence of taking this medication. Some research shows that this medication can be safely combined with stimulants, resulting in a need for a lower dose of stimulant medication and a lower dose of the guanfacine as well. So combining the medication may actually provide broader coverage across all ADHD symptoms and even some comorbid symptoms, such as emotional dysregulation and oppositional behavior, than when either stimulants or guanfacine are used alone. The drug may have its most optimal effect on inattention and on working memory, as well as on emotional dysregulation and oppositional symptoms, in comparison to other drugs or to other symptoms of ADHD. It appears that alpha-2 agonists, such as guanfacine XR, work directly in the frontal cortex by fine-tuning signals in neuronal networks and enhancing the ability of the network to transmit the signal. In other words, it reduces noise in the signals in these neural networks and therefore may result in improvement in ADHD symptoms as a consequence. Studies indicate that guanfacine XR does not exacerbate pre-existing tics or anxiety, making the drug particularly useful in individuals who may have ADHD and these other disorders as comorbidities. The drug can be given once daily, with effects shown to continue throughout the waking day and sometimes even into the next morning hours. The drug can be given at any time of day, either at morning or at night, and this does not appear to change the likelihood of improvement from the medication. The drug can also be given once daily at bedtime, which may improve sleep onset, because one of the side effects of this medication, particularly when it is first being used, is sedation. As with the other ADHD medications, there are certainly side effects from using guanfacine XR. These are relatively benign, though they may be annoying to some patients. As you see here, the most common side effect in response to guanfacine is sedation or sleepiness. This may be to a mild to moderate degree when the drug is first initiated, and it may be somewhat greater later in the day than in the morning hours. However, the degree of somnolence or sleepiness is not such that it seems to interfere with psychomotor performance or with attention to tasks. This side effect may also be short-lived, in that the longer the individual stays on the medication, the less evident it is likely to be. As you can see here, some individuals who take this medication report of an increased frequency of headaches, greater fatigue, some sense of sedation, and abdominal pain. A very small percent report decreased appetite, usually for the noon meal, and a small percent also report some nausea or some increased risk of vomiting. Lethargy is rare with this medication, as is irritability. A few individuals may report a dry mouth or a dry cough, and an even smaller percentage reported some dizziness in response to the medication. As with the other ADHD drugs, this drug has an effect on blood pressure and on heart rate, but notice that the effect is in the opposite direction, decreasing blood pressure and pulse and decreasing heart rate. And again, that is because guanfacine is an antihypertensive drug. The side effects appear to decrease over time, but in some individuals may last longer than 2 weeks. It is suggested that in individuals who are taking guanfacine in combination with valproate, an anti-epileptic medication, that blood levels of the guanfacine may need to be monitored, as there may be some interaction of these two drugs, resulting in a higher than typical blood level of guanfacine. And the package insert for this medication indicates that it should not be used in individuals who are taking Abilify. There are other medications that have been used in the management of ADHD off-label in the United States. 30 years ago, when methamphetamine was commercially available in pharmacies, studies indicated that this more potent version of amphetamine was even more effective than dexedrine or benzedrine for the management of ADHD symptoms. However, methamphetamine has a very high abuse liability. Typically, this drug is not available in many regions of the U.S., and many pharmacies do not wish to stock this medication because of the high likelihood that it may be stolen or because of its abuse liability. Tricyclic antidepressants were tested with ADHD individuals beginning in the 1970s and later. Such tricyclics were found to be beneficial in improving ADHD symptoms, but they also had a lower safety profile and greater side effects, and required that individuals be given an EKG before taking the medication in order to rule out individuals who might have cardiac difficulties. Because these medications were associated with a somewhat increased risk for cardiac problems, the medications are no longer recommended for use with ADHD, especially given the availability of norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors such as atomoxetine, which have a far greater safety profile. Other norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, like atomoxetine, are available for use with ADHD, but they do not have FDA approval, such as reboxetine, for instance, which has been shown in several studies to result in a positive improvement in ADHD symptoms. Bupropion also may produce positive benefits for ADHD. Other antihypertensive drugs have been used in the treatment of ADHD, such as immediate-release guanfacine or clonidine. But given that more research is available on the safety and effectiveness of guanfacine XR or Intuniv, that drug would be the preferred antihypertensive drug to use if one were considering using this category of medications for managing ADHD children or adults. Some pediatricians have reported positive benefits from using antihistamines in managing ADHD children. Generally, however, these medications are not recommended given the availability of the many different stimulant delivery systems, atomoxetine, as well as guanfacine XR. Those drugs would be used preferably before using an antihistamine to manage ADHD symptoms. A number of issues arise in selecting which medication might best be used with a particular case of ADHD. One issue is the urgency of the need to control the symptoms of ADHD. If an individual with ADHD is in a crisis situation or where certain harms are about to befall them if their ADHD symptoms are not managed immediately, then it might be preferable to begin with a stimulant. That is because stimulant medications can act quickly, and the dose of medication can be titrated up to a therapeutic level within a matter of days, if the need arises for such urgent control of symptoms. Atomoxetine can take several weeks to reach an appropriate therapeutic dose, as can guanfacine XR. So, if there is an urgent need to control ADHD symptoms very quickly, then stimulant medications may be preferable. The duration of action of the medication may also be a consideration. For individuals who only need to control their ADHD symptoms for a short period of time, say for a few hours, then the immediate release forms of the stimulants may be the drug of choice. On the other hand, most ADHD individuals need to have their symptoms controlled across most, if not all, of the waking day. For this reason, the extended release formulations of the various medications have become the treatment of choice or the standard of care for managing ADHD. Certainly, there is an issue of consumer acceptability of a particular medication. Because of the propensity of the trade media to alarm individuals about the stimulant medications, one may find that families of ADHD children or ADHD adults may show some disinclination to taking stimulant medications. Sometimes this difficulty in accepting the use of stimulant medications can be overcome by sharing appropriate scientific information with patients so that they come to understand that the media has likely misrepresented the difficulties that individuals might have in taking stimulant medications. For instance, the fear that they may have that the drugs are addictive when taken as prescribed, or the fear they may have that children who take stimulants may have an increased risk of drug abuse later in life. As I showed in this course on an earlier slide, both of these are unsupported misconceptions about ADHD medications. One certainly needs to consider whether or not parents have the capacity to supervise the use of medication in determining which medications ought to be used. Generally, stimulants have a higher abuse liability than do the non-stimulants, and therefore, if parents are unable to supervise the medication properly, then a non-stimulant might be preferred. Also, one needs to take into consideration whether the patient with ADHD is already taking other medications that might contraindicate the use of a particular medication. For instance, as I've already indicated, if an individual is taking Abilify, then one would not wish to select Intuniv or guanfacine XR for use in that patient. If an individual is already taking a stimulant or is already abusing stimulants, then one would not wish to prescribe stimulant medications for that individual. Certainly, as I've mentioned already, one needs to consider whether there is a family history or a personal history of having had previous adverse reactions to a particular medication. In that case, one might wish to use a different medication with this individual. One also needs to consider whether a child has a pre-existing growth problem that could be exacerbated by use of, for instance, stimulant medications or atomoxetine, which are known to have some mild effects on growth retardation. Also, one needs to consider whether or not there are pre-existing bedtime behavior problems, insomnia, or sleeping difficulties, as some of the medications, such as stimulants, can make these difficulties worse in some individuals. Where there are pre-existing bedtime behavior problems or sleeping difficulties, a non-stimulant might be a better choice. One also needs to consider the degree of anxiety or obsessive-compulsive disorder that may be present in an individual. Some research does show that stimulants have a tendency to exacerbate anxiety or obsessive-compulsive behavior or tics or Tourette syndrome. And although this is not generally true across all individuals who have these disorders, there are some reports of the literature, or in the literature, of just such exacerbation. And so clinicians might wish to start with lower doses of stimulants with such individuals having these comorbidities, and titrate the dose of medication more slowly while monitoring the comorbid disorder more carefully to see if it is being exacerbated by the stimulant. Better yet, these may well be cases in which non-stimulants like atomoxetine or guanfacine would be the first choice of medication to use before proceeding to use a stimulant. The same applies, as I've said, in cases with tics or Tourette's syndrome. One also might wish to consider whether or not there is a stimulant abuser living with the immediate family. In that case, using immediate-release stimulants would probably not be a wise choice, because this prescription might become available to the drug abuser, either for use in their own drug abuse or for theft and then selling the medication in order to get the drug of abuse, that is, the preferred drug of abuse. So, one needs to consider whether or not there is a drug abuser in the family who might take advantage of the use of a stimulant drug with an ADHD patient. In that case, one might wish to use one of the more non-abusable stimulants, that is, a stimulant with lower abuse liability, such as Vyvanse, which is the Lisdex amphetamine discussed earlier, or the prodrug, or such as Concerta. Both of these long-acting medications, stimulant medications, have a much lower abuse liability than the immediate-release compounds. Also, one might wish to consider using a non-stimulant like atomoxetine or guanfacine XR in these cases. Clinicians also need to consider the availability of these medications to particular individuals, particularly individuals who may be under state or federal health care plans, which may dictate which medications are available under the health plan. Also, one needs to consider the affordability of the medication for the family. More recently released medications that are not yet available in generic form are usually more expensive and therefore may pose financial problems for families. So clinicians need to talk with families about this issue of availability and affordability, even if it doesn't have anything to do with the likelihood that the individual will respond to the medication. Also, one needs to consider whether or not the family has available appropriate medical follow-up care and whether or not such care is affordable to them. In conclusion, I hope you have learned from this course on ADHD medications that there are many medications available for the management of ADHD. At least three kinds exist: the stimulants, the non-stimulant atomoxetine, and the antihypertensive drug guanfacine XR have all been approved by the Food and Drug Administration for the management of ADHD individuals. These medications appear to result in improvement in symptoms in the vast majority of individuals who are treated by the medication, and many such individuals are likely to show a positive response. Anywhere from 65 to 92% of ADHD patients are likely to respond to one or more of these ADHD medications currently approved for use in the United States. The degree of improvement achieved by these medications is often greater than that achieved by any other category of psychiatric medication, making ADHD one of the most treatable psychiatric disorders with regard to the medications that are available for its management. All of the ADHD medications are reasonably safe, typically well tolerated, and generally effective for the management of ADHD when taken as prescribed. The greatest difficulties with ADHD medications may be consumer acceptability, particularly for the stimulants, availability, particularly outside the United States or under certain state and federal health plans, affordability, particularly of the non-generic medications or those most recently brought to market, and to some extent non-adherence to the medications. Research shows that individuals are likely to discontinue taking their medication after several months or several years of being on these medications. The reason for such non-adherence are not well known, but nonetheless may well have to do with the problems I've already mentioned, that of acceptability, tolerance, availability, and affordability. I hope you've learned something about the medical management of ADHD from this course. Thank you for taking this course. I invite you to take other courses on ADHD that I have prepared for this website at your convenience. I also invite you to visit my publisher's website at guilford.com to explore many of the products that I have on ADHD at this publisher. For instance, there are my new rating scales for the evaluation of ADHD in adults, for the evaluation of executive functioning deficits in adults, and for the evaluation of psychosocial impairment in adults. Thank you again for taking this course. Goodbye.